Srivatsa is a curl of white hair on the chest of the Lord, which is a special sign of His being the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In Vaikuntha Loka or in Goloka Vrindavana, the inhabitants are exactly of the same form as the Personality of Godhead. But by this Srivatsa mark on the chest of the Lord, He is distinguished from all others. We'll read the next verse also. तेनेत्तम आहत शत्तर भगवानादि शूकर सूकरह नाकंपत मनाक्वि स्रजाहतैव द्विपह. Translation: hit in this manner, the previous verse, hit in this manner by the demon, O Vidura, the Lord, who had appeared as the first boar, did not feel the least quaking in any part of his body, any more than an elephant would, any more than an elephant would when struck with a wreath of flowers. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. As previously explained, the demon was originally a servitor of the Lord in Vaikuntha. But somehow or other, he fell as a demon. His fight with the Supreme Lord was meant for his liberation. The Lord enjoyed the striking on his transcendental body just like a fully grown-up father fighting with his child. Sometimes a father takes pleasure in having a mock fight with his small child. And similarly, the Lord felt Hiranyaksha striking on his body to be like flowers offered for worship. In other words, the Lord desired to fight in order to enjoy His transcendental bliss. Therefore, He enjoyed the attack. Please repeat the translations, 15 and 16. The demon was enraged when his trident was cut to pieces by the discus of the Personality of Godhead. He therefore advanced towards the Lord and, roaring aloud, struck his hard fist against the Lord's broad chest, which bore the mark of Srivatsa. Then he went out of sight. Hit in this manner by the demon, O Vidura, the Lord, who had appeared as the first boar, did not feel the least quaking in any part of his body, any more than an elephant would when struck with a wreath of flowers. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta Purport. Om Ajnanat Mirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः. नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नाम्ने. नमस्ते सारस्वतीदेवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे. जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद. हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे. सो दिस चैप्टर एंटाइटल्ड द किलिंग ऑफ द डीमन हिरण्याक्ष इज द फाइनल चैप्टर इन दिस सीरीज एंड हियर वी विल सी इन द नेक्स्ट फ्यू वर्सेस हाउ द डीमन हिरण्याक्ष विल बी किल्ड. In the last class yesterday, we saw a series of verses we read where the great fight between Hiranyaksha and Lord Varahadev is being described. It's just like a fighting sequence that we see in the modern world sometimes in a movie, and you can get a very nice picture from here how the fighting is going on. The demon is hurling his trident towards the Lord, and the Lord threw his Sudarshan disc, and that Sudarshan disc cut off the trident, and then with his fist he hit hard his fist on the chest of the Lord, and sometimes it appeared that the Lord also slipped. The gada from the hand of the Lord slips. It's a very exciting fighting sequence that is going on, and it is appearing that it's a very, you know, it's a big fight that is going on between Hiranyaksha and Lord Varaha. But here we see in the second verse that we read, when all this great fight is going on, how is this fight being received or being actually taken by the Lord? For the Lord, Hiranyaksha is actually suffering. He's being hit by the Lord and he's going through a experience of pain. But for the Lord, when Hiranyaksha is striking on his body, for the Lord it's a pleasure. And it is described that how an elephant, if struck with a wreath of flowers, would feel. He would feel extremely pleasurable. That'll be the case with any one of us, right? So in the same way, the Lord, although being struck by Hiranyaksha, is actually not going through any pain, but is rather experiencing transcendental bliss. In this verse, it is mentioned that about the Lord's broad chest, which bore the mark of Sri Vatsa, and Prabhupada writes in the purport that in the spiritual world, when we go back to the spiritual world, we get one kind of liberated. And all of us have bodies similar to that of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Except for one thing that is mentioned here. The Lord has a Sri Vatsa, or a mark of a curly white hair, on the right side, on the upper portion of the right side of his chest. And that's how the Lord is identified to be the Supreme Personality of Godhead, going by the external features. And in some other place in the Bhagavatam, one more thing is mentioned. Apart from the Sri Vatsa, which distinguishes the Lord from the other jivas, another thing that the Lord wears, which the other jivas do not have, is that he wears a Kaustubha gem. So Sri Vatsa and the Kaustubha gem are the two things that distinguishes the Supreme Lord in the spiritual world from the other souls. Now here, in the purport, it is being mentioned that the fight with the Supreme Lord was meant for his liberation. And it was all a plan of the Lord. We have been seeing how this cursing of Jaya and Vijaya by the four Kumaras, Sanak, Sanatan, Sanandan and Sanat Kumar, was a plan by the Lord. And why was it so? The Lord desired to fight. Why do we all fight in the material world? Because it is said that there is nothing in us which is not there in the Lord, right? All of us have the qualities which have been gotten from the Supreme Lord, but currently it is in a perverted manner, it is being exhibited. So, just like we have the fighting spirit, so Lord also sometimes wants to fight, and his fighting is, you know, when he wants to fight, he needs whom would you fight with? You fight with an enemy, right? Now, in the spiritual world, there are no enemies. All of them are great devotees of the Lord. So the Lord selects, or he first comes to the material world to fight, because fighting can only happen in the material world. So when he comes to the material world, there has to be opponents for him to fight. And who can fight? Who can, you know, play that part of fighting with the Lord? Again, only his great devotees can play that role. So the Lord made an arrangement for Jaya and Vijaya to be cursed by the four Kumaras. They were all, Jaya and Vijaya were pure devotees of the Lord in the spiritual world, in the Vaikuntha. So the Lord made an arrangement that they be cursed so that they come down as Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu, and then the Lord engages in a fight with them. So this fight that we are seeing, this battle between Hiranyaksha and Lord Varaha, is actually for the Lord, it is a mock fight. Mock fight means just like the father engages in a mock fight with his children, and the child stands up on his father with his whole body and pushes his, you know, thrusts his leg, his fists, his hand and legs on the body of the father. And when the father is receiving such kicks, it is actually pleasing for the Lord, pleasing for the father. because pleasing for the father, because the father is feeling as if his body is getting massaged after his rest. So that is the experience that the Lord is also undergoing. It's just like an elephant receives a wreath of flowers. So in the Bhagavatam, in this story, that is the story of Hiranyaksha and Lord Varaha, and in many other places, we see how the Lord has a plan for everyone. He has a plan for himself and a plan for other souls as well. If you see in the Bhagavatam, just like Parikshit Maharaj, there was a plan for the Lord, by the Lord, for Parikshit Maharaj. That's how the whole Bhagavatam came about. If you see the Pandavas, they underwent so many sufferings. Again, it was all planned by the Lord. Arjuna was put into illusion by the Lord's will. Arjuna was a great devotee, but he was put into illusion just so that the Bhagavad Gita comes out and the whole world can benefit. Like this in the scriptures, not just in our scriptures, but in any scriptures if you see, the Lord takes special care for his devotees. He plans his devotees' life so that his devotees can quickly come back in his association. Just like Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu. Lord wanted to fight. He sent them to the material world. And he says, shortly you will come back to my association. Haridas Thakur was caned 22 times in the marketplace. Again, it was the plan of the Lord. Jesus Christ was crucified. Again, it was the plan of the Lord. So, if we can just understand this much, that anything that is happening in our life is actually happening by the plan of the Lord, and everything that happens to me is actually good, nothing is bad. Anything that I think of, if I am making my plan, then my plan is actually good. If it's actually bad, because I am making it. But if I agree to be guided by the plan of the Lord, or whatever is happening, I accept it as the plan of the Lord, then everything becomes wonderful. So a devotee should always be thinking like this, that what Prabhupada writes, that for a devotee, he should always feel that every step of his life is being planned by the Lord. If you look at that story of Parikshit Maharaj, how he was cursed, it's a very nice story to actually understand how this whole cursing of Parikshit Maharaj by that Brahmana boy, Sringi, every step, the whole pastime was planned by the Lord for the Srimad Bhagavatam to come out. But in that whole story, in that whole episode also, every step was being planned by the Lord. Like when Parikshit Maharaj, he was in the forest hunting for the deer. He was hunting a deer with his bows and arrows, and suddenly he felt very fatigued, very tired, and very thirsty. And in that state of fatigueness, tired, and thirst, he was searching for water, and he came across Shamika Rishi's ashram, and he wanted water. Now just look at the way how the Lord has planned every step for Parikshit Maharaj. The first thing, Parikshit Maharaj is a pure devotee. A pure devotee is never disturbed by any bodily demands. He can forbear any bodily demands. But Parikshit Maharaj suddenly became fatigued, became thirsty, and became hungry. How could that happen? Because it was planned by the Lord for him to become like this. Otherwise, being a pure devotee is outside bodily consciousness. He cannot be afflicted by this. Then, in this state, when he was searching for water, he happened to go to Shamika Rishi's ashram. Now, and he asked for water. Now just imagine, a king, he's a royal king, right? King of the whole Bharatvarsha, he's thirsty and he's looking after water. He could have, you know, just happened to chance upon a reservoir of water or a river, or people will be, you know, waiting to welcome him, to give him water. But in such a state, he happened to meet a powerful rishi who was engaged in deep tapasya. He was in yogic trance. So this was again a plan of the Lord. Again, otherwise for him, for Maharaj Parikshit to come to an ashrama of a hermitage who was meditating, it is the will of the providence. It just cannot be happening by itself. So that was also a chance. And after that, when he asked for water, the sage did not respond because he was deep in meditation. And because the sage did not respond, he was in meditation, Maharaj Parikshit became angry. Again, somebody may ask, how Maharaj Parikshit, he is a great devotee, how can he become angry? Actually, if you look at it from an external point of view, Maharaj Parikshit's anger towards the sage was not unnatural, because he was a great king, and a king has come in a place where the rishi was meditating, and he was very thirsty, very hungry, and for him to ask for water was natural. And if he is not being served with water, for anyone to be, you know, if you're very thirsty and hungry and you are in this position and then you go and ask for water and nobody responds to that, it is quite natural that you will become angry. But because Maharaj Parikshit was a pure devotee, it was not right for a pure devotee to become angry. So why did he become angry? Again, Prabhupada writes, and in the Bhagavatam it is mentioned, this was again a plan of the Lord. So you see how every step the Lord is controlling, the Lord is planning for Parikshit Maharaj. First, he became fatigued, hungry and thirsty. It was planned by the Lord. Second, in such a state, of all the places, he had to go to a hermitage of a rishi who is meditating, and it is difficult for him to give him water. That was planned by the Lord. Third, he became angry. A pure devotee should never become angry. That was also planned by the Lord. And then, when all this was happening, and then he was not responding. So what could Parikshit Maharaj do? So what did he do? He found that a dead snake was lying there in front of the Muni's ashram. So because he was received very coldly, this was not the reception that he expected. Of course, Maharaj Parikshit knew that these great sages, you know, they are materially impoverished, and he was not expecting a big reception, but he was at least expecting some water. But anyway, that was planned by the Lord. So what he did, he picked up that snake and he garlanded it around Shamika Rishi. And this is the way he thought, he received me coldly, so I will reward him also coldly, in a cold manner. Prabhupada writes that the dead snake lying there where Shamika Rishi was meditating was also planned by the Lord. Otherwise, how come suddenly a dead snake was lying there and Maharaj Parikshit had to pick up that dead snake and to put it around this? So devotee sees in every step a benedictory plan of the Lord. This is what Prabhupada writes. And this is what we are seeing in this particular story of Maharaj Parikshit. In every step, we are seeing that the Lord is planning. Next, what? Every scene is being planned, just like in a drama, right? Every scene is planned by the person who has made the drama. In the same way, we are all his devotees, and everything the Lord is planning for us. And why the Lord was planning all these things? Because something great had to come out of all these things, and the entire Srimad Bhagavatam was to come out of this. And unless and until Parikshit Maharaj later says that, you know, because of all these things, I was forced to give up my family life so that I can actually focus fully on meditating on the lotus feet of the Lord. And that's how the Bhagavatam came out. So continuing with this story, all this we see how it was planned by the Lord. And then further, the Lord has planned the entire event. He garlanded Shamika Rishi, and then he goes away. And after going away, you see how great a devotee he is. He's repenting. Maharaj Parikshit repents. that what he did was actually not right. So this is a sign of a great devotee, because the sign of humility, the sign of greatness is if by chance we commit some offense, he repents. So after all this happened, let us discuss how the Srimad Bhagavatam came out as a plan of the Lord. The son of Mahara, or the son of the sage, Shamika Rishi Sringi, he comes, and then he doesn't come. He hears, because he has that divya, he hears that this is what my father has been treated like by the king Parikshit, and he disapproves of this. And his son, that is Sringi, he curses Maharaj Parikshit. Imagine the great devotee being cursed. Actually, the fault, later on Sringi's father says that the fault on Maharaj Parikshit's side was actually very small. It wasn't a big fault at all, because such a great king has come and he is thirsty, he is hungry, and he has come and he has asked for water. There is nothing unnatural. But this son of his, small son, he took it very seriously. Actually, this just shows that how powerful Brahmanas were at that time, and this was all due to the good governance, good government of King Parikshit, that even a son of a Brahmana was so powerful that he could curse Maharaj Parikshit. Actually, that son was son of that Brahmana, he was little puffed up, and he wanted to exhibit his tejas, his Brahmanical power, and because of that he did this. He didn't actually know the exalted position of Maharaj Parikshit. So he cursed him, and the curse, we know what it was, that from the seventh day from today, a big snake bird will actually come and bite you. And he touched the water, the river was there, he touched the water from the river, and he cast this spell. And after casting the spell, even he felt repentant. It is said that this was the incident which marks the actual beginning of Kali Yuga. Kali Yuga, we know that Maharaj Parikshit, when he encountered Kali, earlier when he was killing a bull and a cow, when he was trying to harm a bull and a cow, Maharaj Parikshit gave him four places to stay. Meat eating, intoxication, gambling, and illicit sex, where it happens, he should stay. But Kali did not find any place, because in Maharaj Parikshit's government, everything was being maintained so nicely. And finally, he gave him another place, that is, go and reside in a place where there's gold. But this is the fifth place, another fifth place, how Kali found entry into this Kali Yuga. That's how it became Kali Yuga, because Kali personality entered. And where did he enter first? He first entered into the heart of that Brahmana. He found a hole in the, Prabhupada writes, he found a hole in the heart of that young boy, and the Kali entered there. And Maharaj Parikshit became the first victim. So isn't this a plan of the Lord? How the greatest of the pure devotee, Maharaj Parikshit, became the first victim of Kali Yuga. And who was the cause? A Brahmana. Just imagine, the best of the elevated people, the Brahmanas, they are becoming the cause. And who is the victim? The pure devotee. It doesn't fit into any logic. The only logic it fits in is, it is a plan of the Lord. So imagine if Krishna can plan to such extent incidences with Brahmanas, incidences with pure devotees. We have Pandavas, we have Prahlad Maharaj, then who are we? And definitely Krishna is planning for us as well. You may ask that why Krishna planned if Parikshit Maharaj was to be cursed, and by that curse he was supposed to give up his family life and the Bhagavatam had to come out. Why was it that the Brahmana's boy was chosen? Samika Rishi's son was chosen for this. So Prabhupada explains this also very nicely, how the Lord had planned this. Because why the son was chosen? Because obviously when the son cursed Maharaj Parikshit like this. The father felt very sorry for him. And then the father told him, you know, you have foolishly cursed the king. He is an exalted personality. And you should never have cursed him. For a very small little mistake, you have given such a big punishment. And then he started crying. Even the father started crying. And the father prayed to the Lord. And the father was actually a very powerful and a very elevated Brahmana. So the father, the thing was done already. It couldn't have been undone. And so the father prayed to the Lord to please somehow forgive his son. And because it was the father who prayed to the Lord had to accept. So although Kali personality entered, but the Lord accepted the prayers of the father. Because the offense was committed by that small boy. So that was the reason that cursing actually happened with that small boy in place, so that the father, when asked for forgiveness, the Lord could accept his prayers. But now if you ask that why the entire, it is actually said that from this point of time, the entire Brahmana community, you know, fell into the clutches of Kali Yuga. So if it is to be, and it is said that the entire Brahmana community became blamed, so as to say, because the offense started from the Brahmana. So why is it that the entire Brahmanical community was held responsible for this act? So Prabhupada gives an explanation in the Bhagavatam from Varaha. He quotes from Varaha Purana and he writes that this was also a plan of the Lord. Why the entire Brahmanical community was made responsible for this cursing of Maharaj Parikshit. And he says that in the past, there were demons who did not receive punishment by the Lord. But they have to receive some, you know, something has to happen. So these demons, they have not received punishment, but the Lord, they had committed some offense, right? So the Lord purposefully gave them birth in Brahminical families, so that in this next life, that is birth in the Brahminical family, they can counteract their offenses by taking to the rules and regulations of the scriptures, by following the Brahminical vows and austerities and penances, and they can counteract that offenses which they had done in the previous life towards the Lord. So the Lord gave them an opportunity, gave opportunity to all these demons to take birth in the Brahminical family in the next life. That is just in the Kali Yuga, so that they can get redeemed by their previous offenses by performing austerities. But the Brahmanas in this Kali Yuga, instead of trying to rectify themselves from the offenses that they had committed in the previous life, the Lord gave them a chance. He's so merciful. You were demons. You were supposed to get punished, but the Lord didn't punish them and he further gives them a chance in this life. But the Brahmanas, unfortunately, did not take to the scriptural rules and regulations in the Kali Yuga, and they further committed offense. They further commit offense, and that's why the entire Brahmana community got entangled into this kind of a situation, into this kind of a setup. So Prabhupada says, he warns us that for the Sringi, for the small boy, son, he had his father who begged for forgiveness for him. But for us, we have to be very careful. We have to be very careful that we do not commit further offenses, and we take to this method of religious principles. For us, we know it is chanting of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So the Lord has planned for us also. He has given this wonderful process of Harinam Sankirtana. Just by chanting the holy names of the Lord, we can actually get elevated. The Brahmanas are actually meant to be executing their Brahminical duties, and for us to do that, we can simply do that by chanting of the holy names of Lord. So like this, the whole story continues, and we do not have time now, that how the father, you know, the next chapter where Shukadev Goswami comes, and then the whole Bhagavatam comes out, and the Lord, we see how he had planned this whole pastime, this whole incidence of Parikshit Maharaj getting cursed, so that by force, although he was a pure devotee, the Lord made him by force renounce his complete family, and Parikshit Maharaj, when he hears this curse, look at the way he responded. Suppose somebody curses us like this, that, you know, not like this, even something, you know, any bad curse, how would we respond? But when Parikshit Maharaj heard about this curse, that he has been cursed like this, he actually was very happy. He took this as a good news. And at that time, he gave up all his family, all his attachment, his entire kingdom to his son, Janmajaya, and he immediately went to the banks of the Ganges, and he sat down in fast, and at that time we see how all the great, look at the way the Lord had planned. All the sages from all over the universe had assembled, knowing that Maharaj Parikshit, such and such thing has happened to Maharaj Parikshit and he has given up his kingdom. All the sages started assembling from all over the world. Vashishta, Angira, Parashara, Vyasa, Narada, name any sage and they were there. And not only all the sages, all the devatas, all the demigods, everyone from the heavenly world, all of them assembled. And at that time, Maharaj Parikshit asked them, please tell me, what is the duty of a person who is about to die? And when he asked this question, and he told that I've renounced everything, all the sages congratulated Maharaj Parikshit. And at that time, Shukadev Goswami makes his appearance. And the same question, Maharaj Parikshit asks Shukadev Goswami, please tell us what is the duty of the person who is about to die. And at that time, Shukadev Goswami begins the Bhagavatam. And so this was the whole plan of the Lord. The cursing of Maharaj Parikshit was a plan of the Lord to give us this wonderful Srimad Bhagavatam. Just like Arjuna was chosen by the plan of the Lord to give us Bhagavad Gita, similarly Arjuna's grandson Maharaj Parikshit was chosen to give us this beautiful Srimad Bhagavatam. And then we are very fortunate that Prabhupada gave us such wonderful purports. That was also a plan of the Lord, because we also wouldn't have understood Bhagavatam anything. All that we have understood Bhagavatam is only by the purports of Srila Prabhupada. We should understand how Prabhupada would translate Srimad Bhagavatam. He would get up in the morning, in the night, at 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, midnight, and he would be translating Srimad Bhagavatam till 4 in the morning. And that is how we have got this beautiful Srimad Bhagavatam. So, we have also, the Lord has planned for each one of us. And everything that is happening to us in our day-to-day life, we should understand it to be the plan of the Lord. And He has so many things are available for us to understand this, to realize this. So we should take seriously to the study of Srimad Bhagavatam and make our life successful. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki.